Good morning. We're trying to get our sound working right, both for us who are here and also for folks who are watching at home. Steve, you can probably tell, has turned up this mic. He's also turned down the pulpit mic. So if you notice a difference, either in a positive or a negative way, please let us know. And those at home, too, if you can hear a little better than usual, let us know, especially because we certainly want to be able to get the words out clearly to everyone who hears. We stand for our first hymn on page 3 in our bulletin. Come, be thankful, people. Come.
To the glory of your holy name. Amen.
a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
son into the hands of sinful men who killed him. Forgive us when we reject your unfailing love, and grant us the fullness of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Old Testament reading comes from Isaiah, the 5th chapter. Let me sing for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it, and he hewed it with the wine vats in it. And he looked for it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What law was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I looked for it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its heads and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and briars and thorns shall grow up. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasant planting. And he looked for justice, but behold, bloodshed. For righteousness, but behold, an outcry. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle comes from Philippians, the 3rd chapter. If anyone else thinks he has a reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the 8th day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness, under the law, blameless. But whatever I gain, I had, I count it as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may obtain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this, or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
When the season for fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again he sent out his servants, more than the first, and they did the same thing to them. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir, come. Let us kill him and have his inheritance. And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. When, therefore, the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to these tenants? They said to them, he will put those wretches to a miserable death, and let out the vineyard to other tenants, who will give him the fruits in their seasons. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on the stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush it. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was talking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds, because they held him to be a prophet. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, and from the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text is our Gospel from Matthew 21, the parable of the wicked tenants. Jesus tells parables. He does it throughout his ministry. And now, as he approaches the end of that earthly ministry, the parables change. They become different from what they were at first. Let's compare this parable, say, to the parable of the sower, as we hear at the outset of Jesus' ministry. There are differences. For instance, when Jesus told that parable, his disciples were not sure what he meant. And Jesus sat them down and explained the parable of the sower, as well as other parables. And if Jesus' own disciples did not understand what the parables were saying, can you imagine what Jesus' enemies were thinking? What? The words of, who is it, Homer Simpson? Duh. And Jesus said it must be this way, so that hearing and seeing they will not see, nor will they understand, lest they come to their senses and repent. Instead, they have had their chance of repentance. So the parables are not clear to them. But look at this one. Jesus' enemies know exactly what he is saying. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceive and understand that he was speaking about them. They are the tenants were about to kill his son. Though they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds, but they held him to be a prophet. The story continues. They waited till an opportune time. So that's one difference. Another difference has to do with the detail in the parables. Early on, when Jesus tells his parables, it probably doesn't pay us too well to look into each and every single detail. In our opening hymn, we talked about bring the harvest in. We are the harvest. We'll be garnered in. And the pure grain will go into the garner. You don't want to push that too far, do you? Because what do you do with the food, the wheat that you put in those big silos? What's it for? It's for eating. Jesus has no intention of talking about that at all. Neither does the hymn. Simply, Jesus is talking about the end of the age being a place and a time when the angels will do God's will to gather in his beloved. But here it is different, isn't it? Every detail means something. There is a master of a house who planted a vineyard. Well, we heard our Old Testament text about the Lord who says, I planted this vineyard, and that vineyard really is the people of Israel. The Lord put a fence around it. The fence is God's law, which distinguished his people from all the other peoples on the face of the earth. He dug a wine press in it for the temple, the sacrifices there, and built a tower. Interpreters there, they give us a couple different interpretations. One is the whole civil structure of the realm of Israel and the way God set up the government, but more likely refers to the prophets. As the watchmen, or excuse me, the prophets are referred to as watchmen. Where did the watchmen do their work? In the tower. And he leased it to the tenants, the rulers, the leaders of Israel, and went away from. So each feature in this parable means something, has a purpose. For instance, when the master of the house sends the servants, we know right away. He is talking about those prophets who came to warn Israel and say, repent and return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. And when they would not hear, they would not hear, who does the master send but his own son? We all know that this is Jesus. So detail upon Jesus himself gives the interpretation. Look, you guys, haven't you read in Scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it was marvelous in our eyes. Don't you understand that I am that cornerstone and that you are in the process of rejecting me? So Jesus is clear, and he is detailed in what he is saying. The third thing to describe about this parable is its antagonistic tone. Jesus told the parables early on to everybody and then explained to his disciples, and indeed some of his parables he told only to his disciples. Here, this is a parable he tells to the people he knows are going to put him to death. Everyone knows who those tenants are. And everyone knows that Jesus has pitted himself against them. Now, it is not as though Jesus were some sort of antagonistic voice from God, like some of the prophets might have been from time to time. But he began his ministry in peace. He worked miracles. He told people to repent, for the kingdom of God was near. And that is the thing that prophets do. Even from the outset, there were those who did not like what Jesus had to say. They were fine with the miracles, what drew attention away from them, but they really didn't like that Jesus would say things like, you know that passage in Isaiah that says the Messiah coming, he will give sight to the blind, and healing, release the prisoners, closes the book in the synagogue, and he says, this has been fulfilled in your hearing. They didn't lie. It's who Jesus claimed to be. For he didn't say, I'm another teacher sent from God, you know, like John the Baptist or Elijah or Elisha. He did not say, I am simply a rabbi who has come to you to give my interpretation of the law so that you can gather together and discuss these things and figure out for yourself. He said, no, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and you will not come to the Father except through me. And that was the sticking point. How could that man, that Nazarene, that guy from flyover country, how could he be God's ambassador to us? How could he be Messiah, God's anointed one? How can he be the one who will rescue us from our dreaded and awful enemies, you know, the Romans? How can he be that? The answer is, of course, you don't know who your enemies are. Your enemy isn't the Romans. Your enemy is sin and death and the power of the devil. You don't want to see those enemies and how they are working in your life. Instead, you want to be the righteous ones. And you have misused that hedge, God's law. You have set it up between yourself and your fellow Jews and your fellow men. And you have not used it the way it was intended. And here's where this parable really starts to hit home. And we have to start asking ourselves, in what way am I acting like one of these tenants? But they took God's law and they refused to live according to it or by it. In essence, what they did, you all remember your catechism and the three purposes of God's law. It is a curb, a mirror, and a rule. Let's think about that mirror. As a mirror, we are to look into God's law and see ourselves. And that's the call that the law gives to us. We see our sin. And we see our desperate need, and we say, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. But you know, you can do this with God's law. You can take that mirror, and you can tilt it just a little bit, so that you are no longer looking at yourself, but you're looking at someone else. And this is a fascinating human game. We do it really deep down inside. We do it because we don't like to look at ourselves as we really are. And when we sense that we have faults and we have guilt and we have shame, instead of saying, mea culpa, my fault, we turn that a little bit and we'll say, your fault. So you might say, oh, look at that. That's the curse of white supremacy that has been with us since 1619. It's the fault of the corrupt system. It's systemic racism. Or we turn it slightly differently. And we say, look at the faults in our church body. If only we did this or we did that, everything would be fixed. Everything would be better. And so it must be the leaders. They're right. Or we turn it a little bit and we say, the pastor says, look at these parishioners. If they just understand what I'm trying to get across to them, we'd all be so much better off. And we turn it another way, and we turn it another way, all in an effort to justify ourselves and to condemn someone else. If you ask yourself, what was at the basis of the Pharisees? What were they all about? That's what it was. Self-righteousness. Self-justification. And friends, if we justify ourselves, pretty much we're saying to God, I have no need to be justified by you. I'm not the problem. The other fellow, that's the problem. In the end, we point the mirror back at God. We say, God, look what you have done. This is why I'm in this situation. It's your fault. And that's a stupid thing to do. That's a thing that will kill you. Destroy it. It will mean that you will no longer see things as they are. And in the end, we pit ourselves against God and say, I will be the God of my life, and you get out of here. That's not the way the parable ends. What will God do to those who have taken his son and abused him and have killed him? He will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits in their seasons. Yes, he will. It happened that the kingdom of Israel, the gospel, the law, were taken away from Israel for its rebellion. It can happen to us as well. I guess at the bottom, the idea is to say to ourselves, before I fix everything else, I need to fix myself. And the way I fix myself is, as we say, return to the Lord, our God. We take that mirror and we yank it out of the position we've put it in, and we set it squarely in front of us. And we say, I'm facing the truth. This is what I am. My conclusion is, I am a poor, miserable sinner. And I need God's grace and forgiveness. Fortunately for us, he says, yes, that's exactly what I gave you. For when I sent that son, and wicked people put him to death, that may have been their will, but it was actually my will and his will to come down, to die. Because in dying, he bore our sin, he bore our wickedness, he bore our self-justification, and our pride, and all the things that we use to accuse others and justify ourselves. He bore that even unto death, to the cross. By rising on the third day, he says, I got you covered. Your sins forgiven. Even your sin of betraying me. Even your sin of using my law against others. So you are forgiven. And therefore, you are in the kingdom. You are in the vineyard. You will not be crushed. Will not because you have been broken into pieces. So let us pray to God that He do just that. Use His law to break us into pieces. Because that is our only hope. God grant that we be restored again, made whole by the blood of Christ our Savior, who died and rose again to do just this thing. And let us look forward to the day when He returns with His holy angels and shine like stars in the sky. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. The offertory is on the bottom of page 13 in our bulletin. We stand.
Hear our prayer.
Everlasting Father, bless the homes in which your
parents to be faithful examples for their children, and children to learn your nurture and adoration. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of love, guide all health care professionals to serve those in need, and give patience to those with infirmities and disabilities. Hear us for the family and friends of Marie Arias, and for Joyce, Justin, Tom, Mel, Dan, Lucy, Don, Renee, Emily, Elaine, Stefan, Bernadette, George, Bonnie, Inez, Dee, Lori, Fran, and Billy. Give healing also to our President and First Lady, the members of our legislatures and judiciaries, and all citizens who suffer from COVID. Cause this disease to cease to havoc in our communities and nation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Blessed Lord, keep us from resentful hearts that begrudge your mercy. Teach us to live for you the life that you have given us, treasuring in our hearts all that is good and wise. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear us, O Lord, and give answer to the prayers of your people, prayed in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, whom with the Father and the Spirit you are God and alone Lord, forever.
Please be seated. Service of the sacrament is on the bottom of page 15 in our bulletins. Please stand. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Please stand.
We have a Sunday school.